doctor to meet Dan. He is seeking for the rights of this nation. His enemies, oh no, he can them overthrow and bring to a solemn emancipation. Scum condensed of Irish Bob, ruffian coward demagogue, boundless liar, base detractor, nurse of murders, treason, spectre of Pope and priest, the crouching slave, while thy lips of treason rave, Irish peasants, feed thy purse, still thy art turbine and purse.
In the 1790s, the people in Ireland wanted to free their country from British rule. They wanted to have their own government, and they were called nationalists because they wanted Ireland to be a separate nation from Britain. Ireland had its own language, Gaelic. It had a different culture. And being an island, it was separate from Britain anyway.
It all came to a head in the summer of 1798, when Irishmen all over the country rose in an armed revolt. It started in the south, in Kildare, Carlow and Wexford, where the peasantry swept to victory. They took their lead from the French Revolution, and news of their victory fueled the rebellion in Ulster. In June, rebels headed for Antrim, led by Henry Joy McCracken. It was a ragged army of summer soldiers. They wore green cockades and pledged to fight for an Irish Republic. They were Presbyterians, but supported here and there by Catholic defenders. Their target was the British Army garrison.
But only half the men who said they would fight turned up. There were all sorts of excuses. Some said they had toothache. Others said they had sore stomachs. While some said that they had sprained ankles. Some even hid in the byre, while others simply sat by the fire.
The rebel army didn't stand a chance against trained soldiers. They fired only two shots from an ancient cannon before they were mown down by the infantry and hacked to pieces by the cavalry. It was the same story at Balnahinch when Henry Munro's rebel army were wiped out. Munro was hanged at Lisburn. And since then, 1798 became known in Ulster as the time of the hurry.
The rebellion was very badly organised. Some would even say it was foolish. But it did give the British government a very nasty shock. The English revenge was ferocious. Towns were burnt, houses were wrecked, hundreds were hanged, including Henry Joy McCracken in Belfast.
Henry Joy McCracken was born in 1767 and was known to all as Harry. He was an enthusiastic revolutionary and climbed Cave Hill with Wolfetone and vowed to fight for Irish independence. After the 1798 rebellion, he tried to get to America but was caught. He was offered his life in return for the names of his co-conspirators. He refused and was hanged in Belfast. His body was rushed round to his family home where a doctor tried to revive him. He failed, and Harry died aged 31.
The British government had crushed the rebellion, but were worried about the French. As long as the French could get a foothold in Ireland, England would never feel safe. They needed to make Ireland secure, so they built Martello Towers along the coast. Then they got rid of the Irish Parliament in Dublin, and all power was transferred to Westminster. The Act of Union of 1801 gave Britain complete control of Ireland. Ireland joined Scotland, Wales and England in the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland with one parliament in London. So on the 1st of January 1801, the new Union flag, including St. Patrick's Cross, was hoisted all over Ireland and church bells pealed.
How did they pass the Union? By perjury and fraud, by slaves who sold their land for gold as Judas sold his God, by all the savage acts that yet have followed England's track, the pitched cap and the bayonet, the gibbet and the rack. And thus was passed the Union by Pitt and Castlereagh. Could Satan send for such an end? more worthy tools than they.
100 MPs represented Ireland at Westminster. They were all Protestant, even though the majority of the population in Ireland was Catholic. The upper-class Protestant landowners who had held seats in the Irish Parliament were unhappy because they lost power. But they soon came to see the economic benefits of the union with Britain. And this continued throughout history as Irish Protestants became convinced that the union was in their interests. In 1803, a group of Irishmen went to France to try to get support for another rebellion. Their leader was Robert Emmet. The rebellion was a failure, and Robert Emmet was executed. His courtroom speech is most memorable.
Let no man write my epitaph until my country takes her place among the nations of the earth.
There were still leaders in the country who believed that Ireland's wrongs could be righted. One man in particular was waiting in the wings. His name was Daniel O'Connell. He had never believed in bloodshed and was more interested in a peaceful solution.
No human revolution is worth the shedding of one single drop of human blood.
O'Connell set about creating a popular mass movement demanding equal rights for all citizens. Although Catholics who owned property could vote, they could not become MPs. O'Connell demanded the right to become an MP. He wanted Catholic emancipation. O'Connell toured Ireland and people flocked to his rallies wherever he went. His message was, stand up for yourselves.
It was on an Irish hillside, in the presence of an immense crowd, that he was at his best. His voice rang out as clearly as a bell. And as he spoke, his audience laughed or wept, grew sad or gay, raised their heads high with pride when he told them they were the finest peasantry in the world, or muttered curses against the government when he recounted its evil deeds.
During the 1820s, O'Connell mobilized the Catholic middle classes and millions of ordinary people and formed the Catholic Association. Priests encouraged Catholics to join the association, and for the first time, the Catholic Church became strongly associated with nationalism in Ireland. The sheer size of the movement gave the Protestants a shock.
The Catholic cause is on its majestic march. Its progress is rapid and obvious. It is cheered in its advance by all that is dignified and dispassionate. And its success is as certain as the return of tomorrow's eve.
O'Connell was unstoppable, and in 1828 he was elected MP for County Clare. It was an amazing victory, a Catholic successfully taking on the Protestant establishment. But remember, a Catholic couldn't sit in Westminster, so what would the British government do? In 1829, the government in Westminster, scared of the threat of civil war in Ireland, passed the Catholic Emancipation Act. Catholic MPs could now sit in Parliament, and O'Connell could now begin to build up the support of Irish nationalist MPs at Westminster. O'Connell was dangerous to the British government. He wanted to get rid of the Act of Union. He knew he had to unite all Irishmen, just as the United Irishmen had tried to do 30 years before.
The Protestant alone could not expect to liberate his country. The Roman Catholic alone could not do it.
Neither could the Presbyterian. But amalgamate the three into Irishmen, and the Union is defeated.
But his organization was having the opposite effect. By bringing the Catholic Church into politics, he alienated Protestants. He linked Catholicism with Irish nationalism. Some of the popular press in England whipped up anti-Irish feeling by showing O'Connell as a man greedy for power, feeding off his people.
Daniel O'Connell was born in 1775 in County Kerry. His house is Derrynane Abbey. His family wealth supposedly came from smuggling liquor from France to Spain. He became one of the first Catholic barristers in Ireland and worked for Catholic emancipation and to repeal the Act of Union. In 1841, he became Lord Mayor of Dublin. He was a great public speaker and a flamboyant figure. To his supporters, he was the Liberator, but his detractors called him the Agitator. He is said to have toasted the immortal memory of King William by drinking a glass of water from the River Boyne. He moved to Italy and died on May the 15th, 1847.
The British government was determined to change Ireland. They believed that the country needed to be civilized, the people needed to be educated. Now, in the 1800s, most children didn't go to school at all. Their families couldn't afford the fees and the cost of the books. And anyway, the children were needed to work on the farms. In 1831, a new system of education was introduced. It was the same for every school in the country, and it was called the National School System. Children studied in classrooms just like this.
Quiet at the back.
Every child would read the same book, do the same sums, learn the same history, sing the same songs. Children learnt the three R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. And the government wanted all Protestant and Catholic children to learn together. The government also decided to make accurate maps of the whole country. They built new roads to open up remote areas, dangerous areas. The Antrim Coast Road, begun around 1832, opened up the glens of Antrim. In the north of Ireland, attempts to unite Protestant and Catholic had failed. The Catholic ribbon men and Protestant orange men were at each other's throats. The quarrel was about land rather than religion. Catholic emancipation seemed like a slap in the face for orange men. The Catholic ribbon man's oath, too, was hardly an offer of friendship.
I, Jimmy Mulcairn, do swear in the presence of my brethren, and by the cross of St. Peter and by our Blessed Lady, that I will aid and support our holy religion by destroying the heretics. And as far as my power and property go, not one shall be accepted.
By now, Protestants in the north had thrown away all the ideas of republicanism they had in the rebellion of 1798. They felt threatened by the rising tide of Catholic nationalism. Some of O'Connell's younger supporters were fed up with his peaceful approach. They wanted action. In 1842, they formed the Young Ireland. They thought that O'Connell was too Catholic. They felt he should be more all-embracing. O'Connell travelled all over Ireland, campaigning to repeal the Act of Union and to bring back the Irish Parliament. He held outdoor monster meetings. The largest meeting took place at Tara. Almost 500,000 people turned up to hear him speak. There were no microphones in those days, so only a few at the front would have actually heard his voice. But the message was clear.
We are at Tara of the Kings. The strength and majority of the national movement were never so well shown as at this great meeting. The numbers here are greater than any that ever gathered before in Ireland in peace or war. Such an army! I have two objects: to overthrow the Orange system and to convince even the most skeptical that nothing but a domestic parliament will do Ireland justice.
But when O'Connell went to Belfast to ask Orangemen to support his campaign, he met a very hostile reception. The crowd rioted as he spoke from the balcony of Kern's Hotel in Donegal Place.
Yells, hisses, groans, cheers and exclamations of all descriptions were blended together in the most strange confusion imaginable.
Come down out of that, you bug beggarman, till we shake hands with you.
No Pope! No surrender!
Falta! There's Dr. Coote coming!
In October in 1843, O'Connell called for a huge rally at Clontarf near Dublin in support of the repeal of the Union. Sir Robert Peel, the British Prime Minister, banned it. O'Connell vowed it would go ahead. There was a standoff and people waited. A line of warships lay in Dublin Bay, guns pointing at Clontarf. Would O'Connell stand firm? All his life he had hated violence. The threat of bloodshed changed his mind. He cancelled the meeting and his followers limped home. O'Connell was arrested and put in jail. The movement to get rid of the Act of Union collapsed. O'Connell remained an MP, but his faith failed. He went to Italy and died in Genoa in 1847. His heart was buried in Rome.
They brought the body of the Liberator back to Ireland. As sailed into Dublin Bay, it met a ship carrying a cargo of starving people to America. They were fleeing from the ravages of a terrible famine.
The landlords and their agents, the bailiffs and the beagles, the land of our forefathers we are, forced far to give o'er. We're gone to some foreign nation to purchase a plantation, to comfort us hereafter, all in America. So fare you well, sweet Craigie Hills, where oftentimes I've rambled. I never thought my childhood days I'd part from you no more. Now we're safe.